switching hats. Well, this morning we are going to be making a bit of a transition in our text this morning. So again, turn open your Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 3. We're going to be going from verse 8 down through verse 17. By way of introduction, I want us to, if you have a Bible open, I want you to turn to chapter 2, verse 11 and 12, because as we sort of set the sort of context for this message this morning, I want you to see what Peter has done big picture here. You may recall over the last several weeks, we've been talking about our conduct, how we're supposed to live or conduct ourselves out there in the world. And it all starts, Peter's message all starts in chapter 2, verse 11 and 12 with these words. He says, "Beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh, which wage war against your soul." And here it is, "keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable." And then he gives the reason, "so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation." That verse, if you think about this one verse, is Peter's way of saying, listen, live the Christian faith, like really, truly live it out there. Why? Here's the reason. So that in the very end, those who are outside of the Christian faith, hopefully will have such an impact upon them that they will glorify God on the day of visitation. They won't look at this in sort of a, when God visits one day, that they're trembling with fear. It's because they've been so impacted by your life that they've come to know Christ, right? I mean, that's what he's saying here. He says, "keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they will see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation." That means your conduct and my conduct has sort of a, I guess you could say, an evangelistic impact to it, right? That's the point that Peter makes here. And then from this text, if you kind of are in the text from 1 Peter chapter 2, starting in verse 13, just quickly rolling through the context and see what Peter has done to bring us all the way to this section that we're in here this morning. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 13 through 17, he talks about our conduct, how we're supposed to live in response to, in relation to the government that's out there. And we won't go over that message. Pastor Jeff did a great job, of course, as usual, communicating to us what our conduct should be like and how we interact and relate to the government. And then in verses 18, really all the way down to 25, he talks in this text, Peter does, about how slaves, if you're in this situation as a slave, how you should conduct yourself in terms of those who would be considered your masters over you. How do you behave as a Christian in that context? You see, he's concerned about the conduct and the weight of the conduct and the impact of that conduct upon those around you. And then last week in the message, in the challenging text, of course, because of the context in which we live in our day, is the section in chapter 3, verses 1 through 7, about husbands and wives. And again, the word conduct is repeatedly used in this text, talking about how some of the wives that Peter was writing to were married to unbelieving husbands. They didn't know Jesus, and he's talking to them to say, by way of encouragement, here's how you can win your husband. You see, your conduct has a huge impact on your very home itself. And then he has a word to the husbands who are believers. Here's how your conduct has an impact in your home as well. And then we come to our text this morning. Notice it begins with the word finally. He's ending a section, isn't he? Finally, all of you. So if you look at this, you have these great bookends. You have chapter 2, verse 12, and it will bookend really almost at the very end of chapter 3. And here he is now saying, here's the last thing I want to say to you by way of conduct. Finally, all of you, he says, have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, and a tender heart and a humble mind. Do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, bless, for to this you were called, that you may obtain a blessing. For whoever desires to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Now who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled. But in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you, yet do it with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience, so that when you are slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than for doing evil. And that is our text for this morning. In this passage, in fact, I think really in this entire section, in chapter 2, verse sort of 12, all the way to the very end of this section that I just finished reading, I think really, if I was to summarize this entire section, I might want to give it the title, "That the World May Know." That's the title that I might want to give it. And I give it that message title for this message in particular, you see, because Peter's calling us to the right kind of conduct, the right kind of living. Why? Because chapter 2, verse 12, that the world would know Jesus. That's why. That's why he wants us to live in a certain way. Conduct yourself in this way so that the world would know, so that on the day of visitation, they glorify God. That's the weight and the impact of how we live. You see, our words are important. There's no doubt about it. We have to tell the gospel, but there's also such a great import in terms of the conduct in which and the way in which we live. Because we all know that we can have the words to say, but we can have conduct that contradicts the words in which we speak. And the conduct and the words have to be aligned. They have to come together in our lives. And so Peter is so concerned about this, he ends this whole section, again, I think saying to us, here's two more things that I want you to know so that the world would know. Two more things. And the first one is this in your notes. In verse 8, he addresses our conduct inside the church. Our conduct inside the church. Here it is. It's one verse. Finally, all of you have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. I think what Peter is really driving at here is he's reminding us that the way we live inside the church, that is the way we behave, the way we treat each other inside the church, deeply affects and impacts how we are viewed by those outside the church, doesn't it? I mean, there's been so much damage done to the reputation, the fame, and the name, and the greatness of our God because sometimes the way believers behave. And Peter here is reminding them, it's not just about your conduct when you're out there. It's also about your conduct in here. When the church behaves in a poor way, when we say the church, we're talking about believers, when they believe, we treat believers each other in a poor way, but the impact of that is astounding, actually. So what Peter does here is he gives them five characteristics. I call them five characteristics of a healthy church. You can call them something else, but they're just five characteristics. They're not all the characteristics of a church that the church needs to have. These are five that Peter drew out for us in this, and I want to just kind of walk through these at the beginning with you to highlight what Peter's driving at. The first one he mentions is unity. And I want us to think about the opposite of what these characteristics are as well. He says we should have a unity of mind. And we know that so often churches have so many problems internally where there's disunity and divisiveness and a lack of harmony, opposite of being unified in one heart and one mind. And Satan actually loves this, doesn't he? He absolutely loves this in the church. And over the years being a pastor, I have said to different congregations that I have been a pastor over that there's literally nothing, absolutely nothing, and I still believe this to this very day, outside of the church that can destroy this church. I mean, the gates of hell can certainly be brought against the church, if you want to say it that way. But the one thing that will destroy the church quicker than anything is the inside, and the enemy knows that. He'll make his way into the inside of the church, and just like he messed with Peter, who rebuked Jesus, and said, "Forbid it, Lord, that you can't go to the cross," so he will mess with you and me. He will do whatever he can, whether it's me as your pastor or whether you as a person in the congregation or somebody else in the congregation. He will do everything he can to stir up discord and division and anger and frustration and bitterness and a lack of forgiveness, and on it goes. And man, we need to be vigilant, don't we, over that. He roams about like a roaring lion, and between the work of the enemy and the work of our own flesh, boy, we have to be on guard. A number of years ago, you may recall the book written by Chuck Colson called The Body. It was a great book, and he had a chapter called Extending the Right Fist of Fellowship. I always thought it was an interesting title. It's a story about a church that had just called a new pastor. It's actually a tragic tale. The pastor immediately began this pretty intense visitation program with the people in his congregation, but the pastor's motives were pretty twisted. It was done more than just simply to care for the congregation. He wanted information that he could actually use. It was pretty disgusting, really. It was only later that he began to use this information against the very people that he had connected with so that he could manipulate them to do the things that he wanted to do. And it soon became apparent to many in the church that he was actually the cause and the source of some of their divisions, their problems, and because of this abuse, he forged this great divide in the congregation where some were on his side and some were on the other side. And the result is that the head deacon in this particular church decided that they needed to ask the pastor to leave. But the only way they could do that was to call a congregational vote. And so every time the pastor got wind of it, the pastor made it impossible for the head deacon to announce this meeting to the congregation. And week after week, they tried and tried, but no success. And then one Sunday it all exploded. A fight, actually, in the church. A fight broke out. Literally, a fight. It all started when the head deacon went to walk up towards the front of the church to speak of the pastor. He trips over a cord and he falls on his face, but he thought that the pastor had actually tripped him on his way up. And so the deacon immediately jumped up to his feet and punched the pastor in the jaw, knocking him off of his feet, but it didn't end there, unfortunately. Many in the congregation broke out in actual physical fights, and then the police had to arrive. What a shame. What a blot on the body of Christ. It's so hurtful, isn't it, to see that kind of behavior from followers of Jesus, nonetheless. I remember a number of years ago reading about Dr. Criswell, the pastor of First Baptist Church in Dallas, Texas. He had a man on his church staff who actually tried to split a church. And one Sunday, Criswell came to the church. He decided, that's it, I'm calling a construction company. And that particular week, he said, well, I'm going to have kneeling benches installed in every pew in this church. And so he did. By next Sunday, every pew had these kneeling benches there. And when everyone came into the church, he addressed the whole congregation and said, church family, by the grace of God, there's never been a split in this church, and there never will be. And then he told the entire congregation to kneel on the benches in prayer, and God healed the rifts that very day in the church that were developing. You see, because they realized what they were doing was so carnal and so fleshly. You think about what Jesus said for his church, what he wants. In John chapter 17, here's what he said. I do not ask for these only. This is when he's praying, right? We call it his high priestly prayer. It's his great prayer just before he gets taken off to be crucified. I do not ask for these only, but also for those who will believe in me through their word. That's us. That they may all be one, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. There it is, that we would have unity in the family of God so that the world may know, that the world would know that we're followers of Jesus Christ. I in them and you in me, that they may become perfectly one so that the world may know that you sent me and love them even as you have loved me, even as you have loved me. You see, that's what Jesus calls us to, isn't it? That kind of a unity. And I just want to encourage you, This is not brought up in the text because we're chasing after this. This is just literally what's in the text next for us this morning, is talking about this. We just want to be vigilant, church family, don't we? Let's not let the devil have any inroads. Wherever there's sort of any sort of rise, the slightest rise of difficulty or problem with one another, let's lovingly, in the name of Jesus, go to one another, be quick to resolve, quick to forgive, quick to overlook an offense, not to let the devil get any footholds here in this campus, and to pray for overall our church that we love called Harvest. The devil will want to do that. The second thing he says is he calls us to be sympathetic, the second characteristic. Now, what is this sympathy that it refers to? If you think about sympathy, it's really to understand what the other person feels, isn't it? He's calling them to say, be sympathetic towards each other. I mean, if you know a person that's not sympathetic, they might even say, well, I have no sympathy for that guy. After what he did, I have no sympathy for him. Well, it's kind of like sympathy. The opposite of it can become actual either indifference or it can be hostility, right? Like, well, this person did this. This person said this. I've got no sympathy for them. You ever said that? I think I have. I'm pretty sure I have. Even if I don't know, I'm sure I did, because it's something that I probably would have said at some point. I have no sympathy. Wow. Really? No sympathy? The Apostle Paul actually says us that this is what we should be like. This is the sympathetic kind of hearts we should have. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. In 1 Corinthians 12:26, if one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. That's the sympathy that we want in the Church of Christ. Unity. Sympathy. The third characteristic he identifies is brotherly love. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 22, Peter addressed this a little bit earlier when he said, having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth for a sincere brotherly love, love one another earnestly from a pure heart. You know, these are all coming, yes, from Peter, but where did Peter get this from? He received it from Jesus himself, didn't he? In John 13, remember what Jesus said to his disciples, including Peter, one of them, sitting around listening to Jesus? He said, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another. And then these two words, just as I have loved you. Just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another. By this, all people will know that you're my disciples. There it is again. You see, that the world would know. When they see a church that is a church of one heart and one mind, a church that has sympathy towards one another, a church that has this incredible brotherly love, all people will know that you're his disciples if you love one another. You know, when we think about the opposite of love, it's easy to shout out the word hate, right? But opposite of love is not necessarily just hate. Perhaps we might want to think of indifference, actually. Right? Sort of, kind of being indifferent isn't great either, is it? Well, I don't hate the person. I'm just kind of indifferent to them. So I don't really actually ever express the love. I don't actually really in any tangible way show love to them. I kind of indifferent. Certainly, hate is not something that should be part of our lives as followers of Jesus. Indifference really shouldn't be either. But this sincere, earnest, brotherly, sisterly love that comes from a pure heart. The fourth characteristic has to do with tenderheartedness. Tenderheartedness. The word tenderhearted here really means to be compassionate. Some translations even render it that way. To be compassionate, it's actually different than being sympathetic, isn't it? In that if you're compassionate, you're seeking to actually in a tangible way to address the need. Sympathy is to understand and empathize with the person in need, but compassionate, it's really the idea more of actually acting upon that, actually doing something about it. Oh, I have such sympathy for them, but if my sympathy doesn't roll over and translate into actually action, what is it then, right? I can empathize with the person, but I really need to move it to actual action. So this idea of being compassionate with one another or tender-hearted, Ephesians 4:32, Paul said, be kind to one another, tender-hearted or compassionate, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. So the opposite of having this tender-heartedness or this compassionate heart is really a heart that you would think of as heartless, and cold, unmoved by the pain and the heartache of others. How could that be in the body of Christ, right? Of all places, we should have that first and foremost here. We have needs here in our congregation, people that have needs. Tomorrow, you could have a new need develop in your own life. We need to be there for each other. We're a family. And then the fifth thing Peter talks about is humility. Humility. Think about the opposite of humility. We run to pride, don't we? Pride and arrogance and conceit, certainly. I don't know if you remember the old song. I remember growing up with it because my stepdad, when it would come on the radio early, early in the morning, he wasn't a believer, and it would go on the song. It's a Mac Davis song, "Oh Lord, It's Hard to Be Humble." You remember that song? "Oh Lord, it's so hard to be humble when you're perfect in every way. I can't wait to look in the mirror because I get better looking each day. To know me is to love me. I must be one super great guy." That's not what he says. "Oh Lord, it's hard to be humble, but I'm doing the best that I can. I used to have a girlfriend, but she just couldn't compete with all of these love-starved women who keep clamoring at my feet. Well, I probably could find me another, but I guess they're all in awe of me. Who cares? I never get lonesome because I treasure my own company. Oh Lord, it's hard to be humble. I'm doing the best that I can. I guess you could say I'm a loner, a cowboy, outlaw, tough and proud. I could have lots of friends if I want to, but then I wouldn't stand out from the crowd. Some folks say I'm egotistical. I don't even know what that means. I guess it has something to do with the way that I fill out my skin-tight blue jeans. Oh Lord, it's hard to be humble when you're perfect in every way. I can't wait to look in the mirror because I get better looking each day. To know me is to love me. I must be one kind of guy. Oh Lord, it's hard to be humble." Wow. You know, and he used to sing this in the morning. I remember it would go on as a little kid. I was in elementary school, and I think about it, and I mean, there's no way that he was that, but, you know, it was more comical, I'm sure, that he sang it. And every once in a while, I might throw out that song, and I realize that, boy, that ain't me at all. But it's a bit of a joke, right? I'm so proud of my humility. Yeah. So what exactly is humility? I like that Ken Blanchard put it this way. He said, humility does not mean you think less of yourself. It means you think of yourself less, right? In the church, like, we really should seek to have, like, to have it on the forefront of our minds, to have a John the Baptist-like humility. Remember John the Baptist in John chapter 3, verse 30? It says, John the Baptist said these words of Jesus. He said, that is Jesus, must increase, but I must decrease. He must become more, other translations say, I must become less. He must become greater. I must become smaller. However you phrase it, the idea that it's Jesus is the one should be magnified and glorified, not me, not you, not anybody else. Oh, that would be true. He must increase, but I must decrease of all of our lives. The humility like Jesus had, the humility that caused him out of his own free volition to leave the glories of heaven to come down to earth. Of Jesus, Paul exhorts us to have that same mind, that same example of Jesus we read in Philippians chapter 2 when Paul says, do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not to his own interest, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a servant. Being born in likeness of men and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. The humility of Jesus on full display for you and me. What do we want to be like as a church is the question. What do we want to be like as a church? We want to be like these things, don't we? I mean, these are the things that Peter identifies. These five incredible characteristics. He could have highlighted a whole bunch of other things. For some reason, he chose those five to those congregations that he's writing to say, you want to have an impact on the world outside? You really want to know? I mean, some of those texts specifically say, by your love, this is how the world will know. By your unity, this is how the world will know. So think about these as kind of, I think I have a little bit of a chart side-by-side thing that you might be able to see on the screen. Just simply putting the biblical characteristic up against the contrary characteristic. Just look at that for a moment. What kind of church do we want to be? Do you want to be the biblical characteristic kind of church? Unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, tender-hearted, compassionate, and humble, or the contrary characteristics of division, dissension, uncaring, lack of feeling, hate or indifference, heartlessness, cold-hearted, pride, arrogance, and conceit? And the obvious answer, I'm sure, for all of us is, of course we want to be the biblical church. You see, one side is literally living by the Spirit of God, isn't it? And the other side is literally living by the flesh. One side is literally one that glorifies God and one that is simply the self-glorification. The enemy takes total control. And so what would our witness to the outside world be like if they saw this kind of conduct among those who profess to know Jesus Christ? Friends, we can't, unfortunately, and I say unfortunately, kind of control what every other church does in this regard. I mean, there's a part of me wishes we could so that we know that every church could be sort of like made to have good conduct. That's not the Lord's way. But we can control ourselves, right? We as a church can say, you know, our church, our lampstand here, our lighthouse, we're going to choose to be like this. And the sad tale is we do know that there'll be others outside of us who choose not to have this. Things happen in churches. Life is not cookie cutter and easy. Harvest has had its hard times without a doubt. And all we have to do, for those of you who have been around, is we have to heal from that and move forward and look to a better day, a brighter day, and just continue to forge ahead and press on and to say, Lord, help us to be a biblical church. Help us not to make the mistakes of the past. Help us not to relive those. Help me not to be the problem. Help me not to do those kind of missteps. Right? All of us to look in the mirror and say, God, please help me not to be there. Help me to be the kind of man or the kind of woman that will always be spiritually minded and live by the Spirit. That's what Peter, I think, is saying here. This is our conduct, and now it should be the impact of that conduct. Secondly, in verses 9 through 17, Peter addresses our conduct in the world. So the first one is the conduct in the church and how it affects the world. The second one, verses 9 through 17, is our actual conduct out in the world, when we're out there as followers of Jesus. The world is watching the church, not only what we are doing inside, and then they would sit back and go, why would I ever want to go there? I hear they're just always fighting and divisions and all kinds of problems. That's one thing. The other thing is when the church is out there, when I'm talking about the church, I'm saying when we are out there, what is our conduct, what is our behavior among the people that are out there? Whether they know we're believers or not. You know, you got the bumper sticker, the honk if you love Jesus or whatever you've got on there, or rapture ready or whatever your thing is that you got on there, and you're cutting people off, or you're, you know, telling people that they're number one or whatever you're doing. I mean, I got rebuked by my own daughter last week for being in a Trader Joe's parking lot because I went down on accident the wrong lane, and the lady was coming up and she was honking at me, and like, and I just kind of looked at her, and I said to my family in the car some snotty remark, and my daughter in the back seat's like, Dad, like, you just finished preaching about your conduct. So after I kind of pulled myself together again, I had to apologize to my family. In Trader Joe's, I'm sorry, I think I hung back at the lady or something like that, and like I'm like that, and I'm like, rein that in, man, rein that in. Now that lady didn't know I'm a follower of Jesus, well, she could have, but even still, our conduct in the world. So when I preach this, it's not I'm preaching this saying like, oh, I got it all together, I know exactly. No, I'm, you know, a mindfulness of this all the time. The world is watching us and how we treat those outside the faith in our daily reaction, how we respond when we are in Trader Joe's parking lot, we feel like we've been misunderstood by the person in customer service that drives us crazy, and we're like, just get me the manager, right? I mean, we feel like we got to get all forceful and angry. Oh, those are difficult things to do. But all of a sudden, you know, we treat the person as if they're garbage because, and they have nothing to do about it even, and Oh, God, forgive us. Forgive me. But how do we respond to those even who are opposed to our own faith? Peter tells us to do three things in regards to our conduct in the world. First of all, he says we should be ready to bless. That should be the disposition of our hearts, to bless. Here's what he says starting in verse 9. Do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling. What? You mean to tell me that Trader Joe situation, I shouldn't have? Right, exactly. Right. You mean to tell me that guy that cuts me off in traffic and then he's like, he gets, you know, he's and you show up at the red light and you pull up just slowly beside him. You don't just look over and just, you know, I'm not supposed to do that? Probably not, right? Yeah. I'm the only one in the church that does that. I know, yeah. There'll be a men's confessional afterwards. Probably it's mostly us guys, I'm thinking maybe, but maybe not. Verse 10, for whoever desires, and now he starts quoting from Psalm 34 in the Old Testament. Whoever desires to love life and see good days. Do we desire that? Wow, that's great. Like, love life and see good days. This is God's picture for us, right? Let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous. His ears are open to their prayer, but the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. In other words, your position and my position, our disposition, should be one of wanting to bless and not curse. Man, to have that when you're going down the wrong lane or the wrong way at Trader Joe's and person comes, to bless them instead, right? When you get cut off in traffic, to bless them instead. When the customer service person is giving you grief and difficulty, to bless them instead. To bless, bless, bless. To be known as a blesser and not a curser. To not be one who has repayment or vengeance in the heart. To not be Liam Neeson, for goodness sake. I mean, I just love still that. Like, I watched that movie. I've seen it several times, the movie Taken, right? How many of you have seen the movie Taken? Okay, we're in good company here. I don't know who you are. I don't know what you want. If you're looking for ransom, I can tell you I don't have money. But what I do have are a very particular set of skills. Skills I've acquired over a very long career. Skills that make me a nightmare for people like you. If you let my daughter go now, that'll be the end of it. I will not look for you. I'll not pursue you. But if you don't, I will look for you. I'll find you and I'll kill you. Like, that's just nothing but vengeance, isn't it? Now, getting cut off in traffic or going down the wrong way at Trader Joe's is nothing like my daughter being abducted, okay? I have to admit that if that happened, I probably might go a little off the rails, but I also don't have Liam Neeson-type skills. But I got to recognize that in the heart, there is this desire for vengeance. So many movies are born out of this sort of repayment and take vengeance things, and I just love those movies as a guy. I like watching them. Maybe this is more of a confessional for me time, therapeutic session. Maybe afterwards you're like, we really got to pray for our pastor. But I enjoy watching those. And part of it is because the heart of justice, right? The wanting to see justice made happen. But guess what? That's not my job. And it's not yours either. That's God's job. That's God's. David Odsberger, a number of years ago, in a book called The Freedom of Forgiveness, said this about revenge. You know, the person that who's a believer or unbeliever even, who doesn't want to bless. Instead, they'd rather curse and they'd rather be vengeful and take revenge. He says, revenge is the most worthless weapon in the world. It ruins the avenger while more firmly confirming the enemy in his wrong. It initiates an endless flight down the bottomless staircase of rancor, reprisals, and ruthless retaliation. This is why you have Taken 1, 2, 3, 28, 75, and 108. I mean, they've made so many movies off of, because every one of those movies, they're upping the ante. It's like, you came against my kids, and you came and you killed all my family. I'm going to come, and I'm going to take your wife. And then And I'm going to go. I'll go back and get you. And now, because you got back at me, now I'm going to come and take your great great grandkids or whatever. Because Liam Neeson's like 700 years old now, right? It's just this endless thing of retribution, vengeance, wrath, and it ends up going nowhere except a bunch of body count in the way. What? Asks David Odsberg. No repayment, no revenge, but I can have the sole satisfaction of hating the wretch. Well, yes, you can hate him. You can nurse a grudge until it grows into a full-blown hate, hooves, horns, tail, and all. But what do you gain in hatred? Everybody loses. Everybody loses. And that's so true, isn't it? Absolutely nothing is gained from it. So to choose to bless and to not curse, to actually dispositionally say, you know, I'm going to seek peace, and I'm actually going to pursue peace. That's what I'm going to do. Of this text here in 1 Peter, Warren Wiersbe says this. It's a great quote. He said, as Christians, we can live on one of three levels. We can return evil for good, which is the satanic level. So think about that. We can return evil for good, which is the satanic level. We can return good for good and evil for evil, which is the human level. That's where often we can find ourselves living. Or we can return good for evil, which is the divine level. Jesus is the perfect example of this latter approach. Well, that you and I would choose that latter approach. You see, here's what Jesus had to say, right? And again, Peter, where did he get it from? He got it from Jesus himself. Jesus in the Gospel of Luke said, but I say to you who hear, love your enemies, he said. Love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who abuse you. To the one who strikes you on the cheek, offer the other us also. And from the one who takes away your cloak, do not withhold your tunic either. Give to everyone who begs from you, and from the one who takes away your goods, do not demand them back. And as you wish that others would do to you, do so to them. If you love those who love you, what benefit is that to you? For even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who do good to you, what benefit is that to you? For even sinners do the same. And if you lend to those from whom you expect to receive, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners to get back the same amount. But love your enemies and do good and lend, expecting nothing in return. And your reward will be great, and you'll be sons of the Most High, for he is kind to the ungrateful and the evil. Be merciful, even as your Father is merciful. In Matthew 5, he said it this way. You've heard that it was said, and this was particularly to the Jewish community more, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist the one who is evil, but if anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if anyone would sue you and take your tunic, let him have your cloak as well. And if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with him 2 miles. Give to the one who begs from you, and do not refuse the one who would borrow from you. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he makes the sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? You therefore must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. The Apostle Paul, of course, deeply impacted by Jesus, is the one who tells us in Romans 12, repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all. If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourself, but leave it to the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. For by so doing, you'll heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. When I read those passages, I will tell you, I don't particularly like those passages. Yeah, you know, you might hear me say stuff like that and think, what in the world? Like, how can he not like I don't like them because they go against my natural man. They do. They run contrary to the grain of my life. I want to retaliate. I want to defend. I want to stand up. I want to take justice and matters into my own hand. That's my sinful fleshly self. But we have to bring ourselves in line with Scripture, don't we? That's what we have to do. So Peter would tell us, this is how you conduct yourself in the world. You bless, you don't curse. You seek peace, and you pursue it. If at all possible, as much as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. That's what he tells you. That doesn't mean a peace that's sort of peace at all costs, meaning I don't say what the truth is, and I don't talk about what's right and wrong, and I don't preach the gospel, and I just compromise to keep peace. That's not biblical at all. But it does mean that we do everything we can to be peaceful, godly, good citizens living in the country and in the location in which we live, to shine the light of Jesus to the people around us as we seek to spread the gospel. The second thing Peter tells us is that we should also be not afraid. Be not afraid. Don't be afraid. You live in this world. There's people that are seeking to harm you sometimes as follower of Jesus. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ, you and I could experience physical or harm in other ways. He says in verse 13 and 14, now who is there to harm you if you're zealous for what is good? The basic idea is that why would anybody want to harm you if you're doing what is good? Well, you would hope not. You know, well, these are just good people. Why would anybody want to harm them? But then he goes on to say, but even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled. In other words, you may live exactly like he told you to just in the previous verses. You may choose to bless. You may choose to not curse. You may choose to live in peace and pursue peace and do everything you can to be a person of peace. But at the same time, it may still result in suffering in your life and persecution. But don't be afraid and don't be troubled. Why? Because God is ultimately the one who will bring vengeance. The just one will bring justice in his time. And then the third thing he tells us is in verse 15, and that is to be ready to give an answer. Your conduct out in the world, as you're out there and as people are looking at you and you're blessing and you're not cursing and you're not being afraid, he says to you, be ready to give an answer to people. People look in at you. They look in at you as a follower of Jesus Christ, and they start to go, what is it about you? What gives? Why don't I see you react and behave the way other people behave? What is it that causes you to live this way? I've worked with you for 4 years. I've been a neighbor with you for like 5 years. What is it? Peter says, in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense or to give an answer to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you, yet do it with gentleness and respect. Having a good conscience, so that when you're slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than for doing evil. This passage instructs us that the starting point for you and I in our interactions with the world and our conduct with the world is setting apart Christ as Lord in our hearts. Having Christ the Lord as holy in our hearts. We set him apart as holy. And out of that, we are always prepared, whatever comes our way out there, to give an answer or to make a defense. When you think about making a defense, it sounds sort of like, you know, we're going to put the gloves on or we're going to go. It's not that kind of defense. A lot of times, apologists of the Christian faith, some apologists, those who defend the Christian faith, and we desperately need those always who defend the Christian faith. I've studied apologetics lots. It's good. It's people that study apologetics. They give you reasons to believe, don't they? You know, somebody says, well, I'm an atheist. I don't believe in God. Well, apologetics basically is our answer. We're not apologizing. It's not called apologetic because we're apologizing. Apologia is defense. It's an idea of giving a defense. Here's the reason why belief in God is rational and reasonable, why you can believe in God. It's giving them information and evidence, things to consider. Somebody says, well, I don't know, trust in the Bible. I can't do that. Well, an ap- apologist as a person who's defending the faith. They're not fighting about it. They're not angry about it. They're not yelling about it. They're simply saying, let me give you reasons to believe that the Bible is the Word of God. Now, I've also seen nasty apologists, mean-spirited apologists, those who are filled with all kind of rhetoric and those who are a bit mean-spirited. They're a bit sort of like, let's put on the gloves and let's go, kind of an attitude. I don't think that's at all what Peter has in mind here. Peter's saying for all of us as believers, as we're out there, you're all apologists in a sense. You may not be a highly trained apologist, one who's like studied all the books on how to provide answers, everything about who God is. But notice what Peter is saying to do. He's saying, be prepared to make a defense or to give an answer. The defense idea is almost like you're on trial. Somebody's asking you, they're inquiring, they want to know. Give a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for what? For the hope that is in you. They've come to you and they said, I want to know what it is in you, this hope that you have. Why? What's that all about? Well, let me give you my explanation of why this is so. That is your testimony, friends. That is you telling, it's Jesus Christ who's done this in me. Now, we certainly have taken this passage and we've made it a lot more about like a bigger kind of picture of apologetics. But the truth of the matter is, in the context, it's really about you and I out there in the world when people watch and observe our conduct and the question gets raised, what in the world is it a difference about you? I don't see you bless and you don't curse. You seek to live in peace. And I mean, goodness, like, what is it? Let me tell you what's going on in me, the reason for the hope that's in me, right? And notice Peter tells us in this passage our demeanor, what it should be like. Lest anyone thinks, well, defense, let's put on the gloves, boy, and we're going to have it out, and we're going to show them. We're going to get into the debate, and I'm going to show them. What does he say? He says, do it with gentleness and respect. That's the demeanor. I've made many mistakes over the years in this regard, in all the different areas of apologetics that I've been in through the years, from the time I first became a follower of Jesus and would discuss things all the time with Jehovah's Witnesses, all the years that I've had conversations with Mormons, some of them have been better than others. And you learn over the years that, you know, your demeanor and your disposition matters a lot. A lot. You ain't winning anybody to Jesus by being mean-spirited, by attacking the individual, by being rude or obnoxious. You're not doing anybody any help by being sort of the bull in the china shop, going through. You can be right about everything, but wrong about that because you lost everything because your conduct was not becoming of Christ, Christ's likeness. So Peter says, maintain a good conscience then, right? Do this with gentleness and respect. And then you have this good conscience in verse 16 says, so that when you're slandered, like if you live this way and you behave this way, when you're actually slandered, those who are actually slandering you and reviling you, your good behavior in Christ, they're going to be put to shame, right? They're going to go, we got nothing on this guy. We got nothing on this gal. Like, but are we giving them something? That's the thing. Let's not give them anything. Let's do this with gentleness and respect. The Apostle Paul did this all through the book of Acts when he gave his defense. He was brought before those who were trying him, who put them through before Felix and Festus and others, and he made his apologia. He made his defense. He shared his testimony. That's what he did. He said, there was a day that I was going down this road and I was fighting against God and God appeared to me and a bright light shone around me and Jesus' voice said to me this and my life was forever changed. Scales fell from my eyes. That's what he did. Friends, as you go out there, you have a powerful testimony that you can share to the world. You can witness. You can give them your defense, the reason for the hope that you have in you. Our mission as a church is pretty straightforward and simple. It's to make disciples, isn't it? To make disciples. And to make disciples, we have to have something to offer that's really different than what the world offers. If we look like the world and smell like the world and act like the world, why would they want to have what we have? So if people look in at the church and our lives individually, what do they see? Do they see a people who are living out what's said in verse 8? Humility, love, sympathy, tenderheartedness? Do they see a people who are choosing to bless and not curse? Do they see a people who are like Jesus? our conduct, you see, from the inside of the church to the outside of the church should come from where? It comes from our relationship with Jesus Christ, and it is all in hopes that the world that sees the inside and outside, the world would know, that the world would know Jesus because of our conduct and what they see. Let's pray together. Thank you, Lord, for your word. We thank you, Lord, for loving us. Lord, we thank you that you love us in all of our brokenness and frailty and our mistakes. Lord, a billion times I've failed, Lord, I know. Yet your still mercy remains. Lord, I thank you, Lord, for your love for each one here. Would you help us, Lord, to live the way you want us to live? Peter's given us an extensive discourse in chapter 2 and 3 on our conduct. Lord, help us to let our light shine for you so that on the day of visitation, those outside of you would not be on the outside anymore, that they would glorify God on the day of visitation. But for them to do that, Lord, for them to do that, they need to know you. Help us, Lord, to never get in the way of that. Help us never to be sort of obstacles of that because of our poor conduct. Would you strengthen and fortify Harvest Bible Chapel, Lord, moving us forward as your church, not only here in the North Shore, but all of our campuses, Lord. And Lord, would you also move us forward individually out of these doors this week, Lord, when those moments emerge to bless, help us to bless and not curse. Lord, help us to be people of peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.